Thank you, Josh Kennedy. Point of order, Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On the 8th of October last year, I wrote to the Minister for Green Skills, Circular Economy and Biodiversity to ask some simple questions about the proposed deposit return scheme. But despite acknowledging receipt of my letter, there has been no response from the Minister in over 3 months. Businesses, councils and the public are being kept in the dark over deposit return. The scheme has been delayed twice, the contracts have been hidden from the public, and there is no word on start-up costs, risk to public finances or possible job losses at councils. Presiding Officer, I seek your guidance on how we can ensure ministers respond in a timely manner to provide answers that are very much in the public interest.
Thank you, Mr. Golden. Mr. Golden may be aware that matters relating to ministerial correspondence are not points of order, but in relation to the avenues available to members to scrutinise the government, there are a range of options of which you will be aware, whether in the chamber, during committee meetings and through written questions. And it is, of course, a matter for each member to consider which of these options they may wish to use. We will now move on to topical questions. And I call it question number one, Willie Rennie.
Responses to a recent report by Enable Scotland that highlights that over 250 people with learning disabilities are living in NHS Scotland, with one woman being there for 60 years.
Can I confirm that the Minister was able to hear enough of Mr. Rennie's question?
I think I got the gist of that, Presiding Officer. Thank you.
Thank you. Please respond.
Presiding Officer, it's completely unacceptable for people with learning disabilities and more complex needs to spend long periods of time in hospital. That is why the Scottish Government and COSLA commissioned a working group to look at this issue in March 2020, and the report of the group is expected to be published in the next few weeks. We have already allocated £20 million of funding in 2021 to integration authorities to significantly reduce out-of-area placements and hospital days by 2024. The report includes recommendations for a framework that directly addresses Enable's concerns, a national register and a national panel to support it. This is vital. In addition, the Scottish Government is bringing forward legislation to establish a Commissioner for Learning Disabilities and Autism. The role of that Commissioner will be to fully protect rights with a range of statutory powers that could include bringing individual cases. Visibility and accountability are critical, and the Government fully intends to move forward and ensure that people with learning disabilities and complex needs have a home in their communities. We need strong partnerships nationally and locally to make this happen without delay.
Willie Rennie.
I mean, the problem is that the Government have been declaring this as an urgent priority for years. There were reports in 2018, and the original right to their own home was declared back in the year 2000. Yet 21 years later, 250 people with learning disabilities are stuck in hospital, and the guidance required last year has still not been published. So I hope the Minister understands there's quite a lot of frustration out there. Some authorities think that multi-bed units are appropriate, but that is just a new form of institutionalised living. Will the Minister rule out multi-bed units?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I understand some of the frustration that is out there. I've heard that frustration when I've talked to folks with lived experience and people actively involved in the learning disabled and autism communities. The guidance that is issued on the Community Change Living Fund is clear that it should be used to design community-based solutions that negate or limit future hospital use and out-of-country replacements. Going forward, We will work closely with HSCPs to ensure that funding is spent in line with the guidance and the contents of the upcoming delayed discharge report when published. I think the use of the term multi-bed units is not a good one. We know that people can share homes and thrive well. That happens here in my constituency in Aberdeen Central and across Scotland. But the use of the term multi-bed unit tends to lead me to think, and I'm sure Mr. Rennie is of the same view, of an alternative to hospital. That is not what we want here. We want people to have homes in their communities.
Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I agree with Willie Rennie's concerns, which he's expressed. But specifically, we've seen already this year the practice, an unlawful practice, of sending elderly patients to locked Scots care homes and units, and that being banned, and NHS Glasgow specifically being taken to court for that by the Equality and Human Rights Commission. So can I ask the Minister, specifically looking at the data which has been uncovered on this, will the Scottish Government agree to an independent review of all vulnerable individuals living in these facilities?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, has gone through the process of a short life working group looking at all of this. We will act on their recommendations and act on the recommendations and asks of enabled as we move forward. What we have to ensure, and this is I agree completely and utter with Mr. Briggs, is that in all of this we take a person-centred approach, looking at people's needs individually, and that we put human rights at the very heart of all the work that we do in this regard.
Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As we've already heard, Enable Scotland's report calls for a community first principle, the commissioning of support for all adults and children who have a learning disability in Scotland. The report welcomes the Community Living Change Fund, which has £20 million ascribed to it. But what Enable Scotland have said in the report is, and I quote, it's not a lot of money, but per HSCP area and per person. And indeed, they go on to say that it hasn't always led to real and meaningful action for people in communities. So will the Minister share evidence of how that fund is being used? And will he commit to further national funding to build the availability of high quality, sustainable support in every community?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I am more than happy to keep Parliament informed of how that £20 million is being spent. I can assure Parliament that I will be keeping a very close eye on how that resource is being utilised. And of course, as we move forward, in order to get this right, we will have to look at further resourcing in the future to ensure that we do our level best for those folks with learning disabilities and more complex needs.
Julian Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Enable Scotland's report highlighted that people with learning disabilities may be placed in inappropriate settings, such as care homes for elderly people. What action can the Scottish Government take to ensure that provision of appropriate residential care for younger people, including those with learning disabilities, is expanded?
Minister.
I didn't quite get all of that, but what I would say to Ms Mackay on her final point is that we have got to get this right for everyone. And we need to listen to individuals around about what their needs are. And we know that the needs of young people are often different from older folks. So in order to get this right, we need to ensure that we're listening to young people and their families to ensure that the right provision is in place so that folks can lead as free and independent lives as possible.
Question number two, Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on any discussions it has had with OVO Energy regarding its reported decision to reduce its workforce by 1,700 employees.
Minister Ivan McKee.
I'm concerned to learn of OVO Energy's plans to reduce its workforce by 1,700 across the UK and the implications they may have for staff in Scotland. following reports that they plan to close sites in Perth, Cumbernauld and Dunfermline. This will be a very anxious time for OVO's employees, their families and the local areas. I sought an urgent meeting with the company and will speak tomorrow to Adrian Letts, the CEO of OVO's retail energy business, where I will seek clarity on the potential impact on Scotland. Scottish Enterprise is also in contact with OVO and will work with them to look at ways of mitigating the impact on Scottish jobs. Should job losses happen, we will provide support for all affected employees through an initiative for responding to redundancy situations, the Partnership Action for Continuing Employment, PACE.
Jim Fairley.
I'd thank the Minister for that answer. And you'll no doubt be aware about how concerning this news is for people right across the country. At the Perth site alone, in my constituency, there are some 700 employees who have no idea what their employment status is going forward. And as you've just pointed out, OVO plan to cut two offices in Edinburgh, one in Dunfermline and one in Cumbernauld. So the strength of feeling towards this announcement is going to be felt by members right across this chamber. Does the Minister agree with me that these announcements are not in keeping with what senior management at OVO told employees and politicians when they bought over the SSE retail arm? And what support will the Scottish Government provide to the employees impacted by this decision?
Minister.
I do absolutely share the members' concerns about the situation as it's unfolding across various sites in Scotland. And I know that Jamie Hepburn, MSP, and Stuart MacDonald, MP, have already met with OVO with regards to the situation unfolding in Cumbernauld. And when I meet with OVO tomorrow, I shall make these very points to understand the rationale behind their decisions and how this squares with previous statements they have made with regard to the importance of the Scottish sites to their operation. As indicated to the member previously, Scottish Enterprise and PACE are engaged, stand ready to be engaged with the workforce to offer support to them if the situation emerges where job redundancies do take place.
Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Minister. When OVO agreed to acquire SSE Energy Services, the OVO Chief Executive and Founder Stephen Fitzpatrick said, as quoted on their company's own website, SSE and OVO are a great fit. They share our values on sustainability and serving customers. They've built an excellent team that I'm really looking forward to working with. Now we see them systematically and rapidly dismantling that excellent team. Does that mean that the values of SSE and OVO means that their workforce is dispensable? And is the Minister as disappointed as I am at this decision?
Minister.
Yes, I am very disappointed by the decision, and when I meet with OVO to seek clarification on their change in position and why they have a different attitude now than what they did previously, and I shall work to understand the rationale behind this decision, because on the surface of it, it doesn't look to be the right decision for the employees, for their communities, or indeed for OVO Energy, walking away as they are from such a valued workforce. I shall endeavour to find out as much information as I can from the company tomorrow to impress on the importance of the situation and to encourage them to review the decision and take alternative measures.
Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There's real anger in Perth at this move by OVO, who just 2 years ago, when they took over SSE's retail arm, said that they were committed to maintaining a presence in the city. Along with my colleague Liz Smith, I'm due to be meeting OVO later this week. The Minister said he's seeing them tomorrow. Will he explore with OVO the extent to which existing staff might be able to continue in their jobs working remotely and from home if they're not able to relocate to Glasgow or some other place where OVO are maintaining a presence?
Minister.
Indeed I shall, and I will impress on the company tomorrow when I meet with them, as I said, the importance of these jobs to local communities, but also to understand the commercial logic for making these decisions. And really explore other alternatives to keep these jobs in place as they are at the moment, while meeting the company's requirements. I shall also explore the situation with regards to the options for work from home for employees. The situation clearly we're in now with changes in working patterns made that a very realistic and practical possibility. And I shall question the company on the extent to which they've considered that option and are able to implement that for employees in Perth and other affected locations.
Mark Ruskell.
Thanks. This isn't the first time that OVO have broken promises to their staff, with hundreds laid off in the past. Could I ask the Minister, can we expect companies who contravene the government's fair work agenda to face any penalties as a consequence of their actions? And what support can he bring forward through the Tay Cities deal to ensure that there are new opportunities and support for workers in the months ahead, as was achieved with the closure of Michelin and the support given to workers there during that job loss?
Minister.
We've shown endeavour to look at all of those possibilities. With regard to the Fair Work agenda, the Scottish Government takes that very seriously and increasingly so. And this morning, I actually met with Fair Work Convention on their plans to move the agenda forward, how the Scottish Government can support them in that. So that is something we discuss with all employers in Scotland at every opportunity to make them aware of our position with regards to Fair Work. With regards to the specifics of the city region deal, then clearly that is something that can be explored. Clearly there are other priorities already identified for the resources that are being deployed there, but I'm quite happy to speak with the relevant people within the relevant minister and others to discuss what the possibilities are with regards to opportunities that may be created as a consequence of the deployment of the funds from the City Region deal.
Thank you. That concludes topical questions. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 2849 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on changes to this week's business. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press their request to speak button now. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And moved.
Thank you, Minister. No member is asked to speak against the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 2849 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed.